Welcome back. What we're going to do now is to take some of what we've talked about and put it into a more modern perspective with the DNA, the genetic variation of people who are living in Europe today. So we've been looking at the data from this study from 2019, where they looked at 523 ancient genomes spanning 8,000 years, and really looking at that impact of the Yamnaya expansion. But I had laid the groundwork in that conversation about these three major sources of these three major populations that provided the genetic variation, sort of the source populations for the people currently living in Europe. I wanna pick that thread up and talk about that in this video. In the 2019 paper, buried deep in their, well, it's not deep, buried in their supplemental information, which is, so in a research paper, what scientists will often do is present the sort of the most important or the data that best demonstrates the study that they did in that publication itself. But they'll include a bunch of other studies that they did, a bunch of other pieces of information in what we call supplemental information. And so it's published online, but it's not part of the actual paper. And so in that sense, it's a little more difficult to get to. But for this paper, this 2019 paper, there were 341 pages of supplemental data presented with this paper. It was a fairly controversial paper, as I hinted at with the sort of the echoes of Cosina's archaeology in it. And so they needed to really to grapple with that, and they did most of their grappling with that in the supplemental. So anyway, the other thing that they presented in the supplemental data set was this admixture map of the ancient people that they included. So the 523 ancient genomes over the 8,000 years. So they've included them here. Now, I wanted to take a look at this. Well, actually, let me make it a little bit bigger so you can see it a little bit better. So it's color-coded, and I want you to forget the color coding used for the maps before. So even though it's the same paper and it's the same authors, I don't entirely understand why, but they decided to use kind of the different coloring system. The same colors, but give them different associations with different populations in their genetic admixture map, which as a scientist, it bugs me just a little bit, because in my lab we try really hard to be very consistent with our colors so that things make sense across papers. But anyway, okay. But you're smart, you can do this, I know, you're Berkeley students, you're the smartest ones there, smartest ones in the world, you got here, this is amazing. So you can frame shift your colors in your mind, I know. So thinking here, using the key that I've provided here. So the teal color shows the Anatolian farmers, so this is the southern, you know, some people out of that southern, out of those different climes that we were looking at. You have the green or the Iranian farmers, orange, the Western Siberian hunter-gatherers. So this is echoes of that, the ancient North Eurasians that we'll talk about soon. Red are the Eastern Siberian hunter-gatherers and Anatolian hunter-gatherers. Remember, Anatolia is basically where Turkey is today. And then blue, that darker blue, are the Western European hunter-gatherers. And so what I want you to see here is that they've broken up these, they've divided these ancient genomes into geographic regions, and notice that none of these people is just one population. You know, you saw this with the pie charts, but I'm hoping that by seeing it in the same information, the same data, in a different format, so pie charts, admixture maps, that you're seeing that nobody's just one population, that all of these different people have genetic ancestry from populations before them. And remember, these are ancient peoples, and so then they contributed genetic variation to the people today who are also made up of different populations. So as we were thinking about that reticulation, so that dividing apart and coalescing back together, that reticulated nature of human populations dividing coming back together, that you're looking at snapshots of this in time. And so here's one piece of this. So this is the ancient, And now let me show you some modern genetic variation. I'm going to go back to a paper from 2014 and show you some data out of that paper. So here gives you a sense of these living populations, and then also the more elaborate figures, the diamond and the triangles, those are ancient genomes. They only had four ancient genomes in this paper. Like I said, it's a field that has moved very fast over the last 5 or 6 years. So this is another admixture map that I took out of their supplemental information. So remember, this is the extra data, the extra analyses that people often present to papers published in Nature and Science, these really big, high-profile journals where the papers have to be very short. So a lot of interesting information is buried in the supplemental information. So this is a whole series of admixture maps. So in admixture mapping, we've talked a little bit about this before, but let's talk about it a little bit more. In admixture mapping, the scientist decides how many groupings they want the analysis to identify in the genetic variation that's being analyzed. So here you have a whole bunch of individuals, mostly living people. Over on the far right-hand side are the four ancient genomes included in this particular study. And then they have told the analysis how many groups to find. K. What is the number of K? K is the number of clusters that the analysis is looking for. And the scientist sets K. Let's look at this one by one. So this is that data set when they ask the analytical method to identify two. Here is the analysis when they ask for there to be three, four clusters, five, six clusters, seven, eight, nine, 10 clusters. Again, the scientist is telling the analysis how many clusters to find, and then it's showing those clusters as ancestry groups in the genetic variation, the genomic variation of all of these people. So then we get to 15, and then all the way up to 20. Are you noticing that no matter how many ancestry groups, how many clusters the scientist asked the analysis to find, it found that many? And notice that there's a whole lot of overlap. There are not really clear distinctions. They're not clear clusters of ancestry groups. We can see this in another way. Let me show you another figure. So here is a principal component analysis from that same 2014 paper. Now, principal components, some of you may already know what principal components are. For those of you who don't, let me see if I can just really quickly describe it for you. Let's say that you are taking 10 measurements of something, and you know that no one measurement really captures the variation in that you're looking for across your population in those 10 measurements. So you can do a principal component analysis, which basically looks at those 10 measurements in multidimensional space. So rather than thinking and plotting your data in just three dimensions, you can plot it in multiple dimensions, so like nine dimensions when you have 10 measurements. And so this is what you can do with genetic variation as well. You can do this principal component analysis where you're looking for, in multidimensional space, a through line in the multidimensional space that accounts for more variation than any one particular measurement in your population can account for. And so that's dimension one, and then the one that accounts for the next largest amount of variation, can it describe the next largest amount of variation, that's dimension two. So that's how principal component analysis works, and it will have dimension one, two, three, four, five, all the way down to almost however many parameters that you've included in your analysis. So this is just dimension one and dimension two, the two vectors that describe the most variation in the genetic variation across Europe in today in this genomic analysis. And what I'm showing you this for is not for you to squint and try to find all the teeny tiny little names and figure it out, but to notice the spread. Notice that all of it is spread out. And that there are, there's clusters, but there's lots of connectivity between those clusters. So the genetic variation is very clinal. We can decompose this into thinking about just three points. So remember I mentioned before, these three major populations that had given rise to the Europeans, that sit in that genetic ancestry of Europeans: early European farmers, Western hunter-gatherers, and ancient North Eurasians. So when you look at humans living in Europe today, so modern Europeans, mostly they have genetic ancestry with the early European farmers and these Western hunter-gatherers to a certain degree, but they also have a contribution of these ancient North Eurasians, this other ghost population that I mentioned at the beginning of this module. So Europeans are some degree of variation, combination of those three major clusters. Hopefully this is ringing a bell of something that we have been talking about multiple times now, which is this study. This is the 2017 Baker et al. Paper that's showing these genetic admixture maps, these ribbons of colors. But these are, each line is an individual, and the colors show the genetic ancestry groups represented in each of those genomes. But remember, when we were looking at the 2014 paper, at the number of different clusters, what number K is K2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all the way up. In this analysis, instead of the scientist choosing how many clusters, they let the algorithm run in an unsupervised manner. So this is more of an artificial intelligence type of approach. They ask the analysis to say how many clusters best describe the genetic variation in these 6,000 living people. And the answer that came back is 21 ancestries, and the answer that came back showed that 97% of people have at least six of these ancestry groups in their genome. So hopefully by looking at these moments of time in the ancient DNA, you're seeing how constantly human populations have been shifting around on the landscape, merging together, dividing apart, merging back together in different configurations based on the way the climate has changed, based on their technological and cultural innovations, and based on geography. So admixture. It's all about admixture, and nobody is any one population. So while there are these lines that can be used to divide us, the genetic ancestry shows that we're actually an amalgamation of different ancestry groups. Depending on where you are, you change the different ancestry groups that are represented in the genomes, but everybody has evidence of past populations in their genomes today, multiple past populations in their genomes today. And with that, I'll take you to the end. Thanks. I'll see you in the next video.